Hi, I'm Gareth Green, and in this video we're going to think about the two ways in which we label chords. There are two systems. One is called basic Roman and the other is called extended Roman. And it's just good to understand the difference between the two because I know it's a subject that causes some kind of confusion. So first of all, let's just be really clear about chords, how we name them, and we'll take it from there. So if I'm in the key of C major and I want to know what the chords are for C major, first job, write out the scale of C major. So there we have an ascending scale of C major. And then to form triads, which are the basis of our chords, all we have to do is add a third and a fifth above each of the notes of the scale. So here's C, I'm going to add E and G. Okay, so C, going up a third to E, 1, 2, 3, and going up a fifth to G, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's how I get a root, a third, and a fifth. So there's the first chord. I do the same thing then on each of the other notes of the scale. You'll also notice, just while you're doing this little exercise, that you should end up with three consecutive lines or three consecutive spaces when you plot the notes. So if you haven't got three consecutive lines or three consecutive spaces, you know that one of the notes is wrong. So useful double check. But just for now, let me just quickly whiz through putting the third and the fifth above each note of the scale. So there we have them. The basic, what we call the diatonic chords for C major, the chords that come inside the key. When we then label those, we can do them in Roman numerals. Remember, we use Roman numerals to label chords rather than any other numbers because numbers are used for all sorts of things. A little three might mean there's a triplet. We have bar numbers, we have fingering. So that's why we use Roman numerals. So we know when we see Roman numerals, we're talking about chords. And we simply number off each degree of the scale. So that's number one, number two, number three, number four, number five, number six, number seven, and this one is not number eight because C, E, G is a repetition of C, E, G. So it's number one again. So that's how the system works. Now that's the basic system. So if I'm in, you're going to use the basic Roman descriptions, I'm simply going to write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Simple as that. Okay, now in extended Roman, we try to make a difference between major and minor chords. That's why most of the videos that I tend to make, I make them in basic Roman because it's just easier and quicker and you don't have to get bogged down in, oh, is this a major chord? Is this a minor chord? You know, what do we do with this? So in order to do extended Roman, it has its uses because it flags up major and minor chords. But then you've got to think, well, what makes a major chord? What makes a minor chord? And one of the things that we just need to be clear about for a moment is this. Many people say to me, well, it's easy, isn't it? Because if you're in a major key, all the chords are major. If you're in a minor key, all the chords are minor. Not true. So if you're in a major key, let me tell you this, chords 1, 4, and 5 are your major chords. Okay, so 1, 4, and 5 are the major chords, and we call them the primary chords. They're the primary chords, they're the most likely chords to be used, they're the kind of most important chords in the hierarchy of a major key. So it's quite useful just to know that, because if you're not sure about what's major or minor, if you're in a major key, to know that 1, 4, and 5 are your major chords is quite useful. Now, your chord 7 in a major key is a diminished chord, and the others are minor. So 2, 3, and 6 are your minor chords. So when we're putting this into extended Roman, what we do is we put the major chords in uppercase and we put the minor chords in lowercase. So if I'm in extended Roman, chord one in a major key is going to be in uppercase because it's major. Chord two is minor, so I'm going to write it like this. We may or may not have these tops and bottoms on them, that's up to you. But it's done in lowercase because it's minor. Chord three is minor, so that's going to be another one in lower. But four is major, so there we go there. Five is major, and so we go on. Six is minor, so we put that in a lowercase. Now, seven is diminished, so that just needs a slightly different treatment if you want to flag up that it's diminished. So we'll just leave that for now because we're just trying to focus on major and minor chords. But that's the only difference. So if you want to get into sorting out which are major chords, which are minor chords when you label your chords, use the extended Roman system. Actually, when it comes to harmonizing a melody or just trying to work out which chords are being used, there's nothing really that disadvantages you if you use basic Roman and you don't have to get bogged down in, oh dear, am I using uppercase or lowercase? Now, if you're preparing for an exam, there may be some exam systems that require you to use extended Roman. But many exam systems actually are very happy for you to use basic Roman. But for those who want to make that distinction between the two, there it is. And if you're thinking, well, that's great, but I'm not quite sure what makes a major chord or a minor chord, let me quickly explain that to you. If you're happy with your intervals, this will make sense. But chord one is an example of a major chord, so C, E, G. And in a major chord, the third is a major third above the root. The fifth is a perfect fifth above the root. Now, if you understand intervals, that's great. If intervals are a bit vague, like we're not sure what a major or minor third is, there's another way of doing it, because in a major chord, you can count C as number one, and then you can count up in half steps or semitones, whichever way you know them. So you go one, two, three, four. So if you're going up four semitones or four half steps, and then to get the top note, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven. So if you've got four and seven above the bottom note, then it's a major chord. However, let's look at number two, because number two is an example of a minor chord, the D, F, A. Well, that's a minor third and a perfect fifth. So if you know your intervals, a major chord has a major third and a perfect fifth. A minor chord has a minor third and a perfect fifth. If you're not sure about the intervals and you want to count the semitones, well, let's look at chord number two. What you do is you count one, two, three to get the third, or one, two, three, four, five, six, seven to get the fifth. Okay, so do you see how that works? It's four and seven for a major chord. It's three and seven for a minor chord. And in case you're still not convinced about this issue of inside a major key, we've got three major chords and we've got three minor chords, and why would that be? Well, think about it this way. In C major, there are no sharps, there are no flats. So if I put a third and a fifth above C, it's got to be E and G, because E natural, G natural are both in the key of C. When I do chord number two, it's got to be D, F, A, because F natural, A natural, that's what we use in the key of C. If I made that a major chord, if I made number two a major chord, I'd have to have D, F sharp A, wouldn't I? Because that would give me a major third and a perfect fifth, or would enable me to count four and seven. But I don't want to put F sharp in there because there's no F sharp in the key of C. So this is what makes working with chords much more interesting. The fact that inside a major key, you've got a mixture of major and minor chords. Now, it's slightly different in a minor key. So let's just very quickly think about that. If I were in the key of C minor, for example, well, there would be three flats. I'd have B flat, E flat, A flat. And normally your kind of default position in the general classical tradition, and I know there are plenty of styles that would work in modes and things, but when you're thinking about harmony, the clue's in the title, think about the harmonic minor. So in a harmonic minor scale, you have a key signature, C minor's got three flats, but you raise the seventh degree of the scale by a semitone. So what's the seventh degree? Well, it's B, but it's B flat. So every B flat has to be raised by a semitone to become B natural. So it's important we do that. So you'll find that when it comes to chord 3, we need a B natural there. When it comes to chord 5, we need a B natural here. And when it comes to chord 7, we need a B natural there. Now, that changes the landscape a little bit in terms of major and minor and so on. So when we're dealing with this, let me just rub these out for a second because they're applying to the major keys. But when we look at what we've now got a minor chord for chord 1 and a minor chord for chord 4. So in the harmonic minor, you might be surprised to think about this, that in a minor scale, you've only actually got two minor chords. That's incredible, isn't it? Why are they minor chords? Well, C, E flat, G, that's a minor third and a perfect fifth, or it's 1, 2, 3, or it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it's 3 and 7. The same is true for chord 4. Now, interestingly, 5 and 6 are both major chords. So we've got as many major chords as we have minor chords. So if you look at chord 5, G, B, D, well, B is a major third, D is a perfect fifth, or G, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, it's a 4 and a 7, so it's major. The same is true of chord 6, A flat, C, E flat. So you've got two minors, you've got two majors. You've also got two diminished chords. So number 2, number 7. So in a major scale, 7 is diminished. In a minor scale, 2 and 7 are diminished. Okay, well, what makes it diminished? There's the root note for chord 2. F is a minor third above the D. A flat is a diminished fifth above the D. So great if you're into intervals. If you're not into intervals, panic not. Here we go in half steps or semitones. For a diminished chord above the bottom note, 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So if you've got a 3 and a 6, you've got diminished, and that's true for chord 7 as well. And then when we come to chord 3, this is actually an augmented chord. So E flat, G, B natural. It's got a distinctive sound, doesn't it? That's an augmented chord. So what's that? That's a major third above the bottom and an augmented fifth above the bottom. Let's work that out. So above the bottom going in half steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, same as it would be for a major chord, but what's the top note? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 4 and 8 gives you an augmented chord. And in terms of sorting out your majors from your minors, that's why we use the uppercase for major and the lowercase for minor. And then augmented and diminished chords, you've got to flag up in some other way. Okay, so I hope at least that kind of explains how the chord numbering works, why some of these chords are major, why some of them are minor, why some of them are diminished, why some of them are augmented. And just to establish this essential difference between basic Roman notation and extended Roman notation, that if it's major in extended Roman, you use uppercase. If it's minor, you use lowercase. And then you've got to, there are various other ways in which augmented and diminished chords can be described, which I'm not getting bogged down in now because there are a number of different traditions. It's really why my campaign is to kind of stick with basic Roman, unless you have to go down the extended Roman route, because in basic Roman, doesn't matter what you're doing, whether it's major, minor, augmented or diminished, you just whack them all down in uppercase and then you don't have to worry about it. And the job is done without you making mistakes trying to work out what's what in extended Roman. Just keeps it nice and simple. So I hope that clarifies this essential difference between basic Roman and extended Roman, and hopefully clarifies a few things about how we construct our chords. Now, if you've enjoyed this video and you'd like to find out more, there are many other videos on the Music Matters YouTube channel, but also you might want to go to our website, www.mmcourses.co.uk, where you'll find details of all of our online courses that go into the whole thing about music theory. We've got courses that will take you from the very beginning all the way through up to some quite advanced work, and it's all done very progressively, step by step. On the YouTube channel, we've got lots of one-off videos darting about the whole musical scene. The online courses are absolutely step by step, so you can kind of go through things logically. And I try to explain everything as clearly as possible. You can see me write it down. You can hear me play it with the keys lighting up and so on. So it really helps you to get to grips. Lots of other courses out there as well on analysis, aural training, dictation, orchestration. You name it, you'll be able to find it there, hopefully. Also, while you're on the website, you might just want to click on Maestros on the homepage, because this is our wonderful international group of musicians, all sorts of different people at all sorts of different stages on the journey. Lots of perks in being a maestro, including discounts on the online courses, emoji and badges and all sorts of things, behind the scenes material, advanced sight of videos on the YouTube channel. And also you can join us for our monthly live streams, where we study together in a more in-depth way than we've got time for on one of these videos. And you can actually submit your own compositions, bits of harmony, your own recorded performances, and you can get one-to-one feedback from me on that. So if Maestro sounds like something you're interested in and you want to join a group of other like-minded people for wonderfully supportive stuff, well, have a look at Maestro's.